I'm Abhishek Gupta, I'm from India. I work for a company, Xsprit. And before Xsprit, I was working in Microsoft, Hyderabad. And since this January 2017, I'm working in Xsprit. So my session will be on how to build planetary scale mobile apps using the very recently announced, very powerful, the monstrous database, which is Cosmos DB. So if you are talking about terabytes, petabytes, then you are attending the right session. Or if you are curious, even if your app is not at all looking for terabyte of database, petabyte of database, still you are curious how those apps which are dealing with such a huge databases, how they are managing their databases, so you are in the right session. Before starting my session, I want to first ask, how many of you at anyhow have used any of the Azure services, like Azure Web API, Azure Table Storage? How many of you? Okay, more than 50%. So Cosmos DB is nothing but a very well proven. Microsoft was internally using Cosmos DB since very long time. So when I was working with Microsoft, my flatmates who were working in Bing search engine team, and one was working in VSTS Online, I used to kept hearing from them since almost 3-4 years. Today we have done this in Cosmos DB, Google is having machine learning, okay, we are having my internal ML thing, lot of things. So Cosmos DB was a very well proven 10 years old technology which was internally being used by Microsoft, and entire Bing database is relying on Cosmos DB. So you can see this very well, that Cosmos DB was something which was not announced as alpha, beta, and then general availability. From the day one, it was just use it. It's generally available because Microsoft knows that they are using it since last 10 years, and it's very well proven. It's completely behind Bing search engine team. So when Bing team started writing their search engine, they found that, okay, relational database is not going to solve the purpose. Let's first create our own database engine. So then they started the concept of Cosmos DB. 3 years or 2 years back, when Azure Document DB was announced, that was just one of the smallest part of Cosmos DB. Cosmos DB is one big umbrella. So Azure Document DB is just one part of big Cosmos DB. Azure Table Storage is just another part of big Cosmos DB. So we will see how much Cosmos DB capabilities are, or how you can use it, what new you found today after this session, and what you found that how you can build your planet scale apps, how you can achieve geo replication. Let's say your app went too much viral in Singapore. Suddenly your app are gaining app is gaining users in Europe, US. How you can suddenly minimize the latency if your users are using your app from Europe, from US. So how you can achieve this without writing any single line of code, just by GUI. So replication, just with the help of GUI, geo replication. So this is just the glimpse what we are going to see in next 50 minutes or 55 minutes. About me, I have already told much, and let's move to Cosmos DB. So before telling more about Cosmos DB, we were using relational database, SQL Server, Oracle, MySQL. Generally, normally, in we think that it is solving our lot of almost all purposes, not all, almost all. But now, let's say you want to implement something like Tinder or LinkedIn, where you want to find out your two friends, how many common friends are there between two random connections. So it means you need to find graph related things in it. Your one friend is one node, another friend is another node, and you need to count edges between them, right? So for those kind of things, you cannot establish multi-value relationship. This is a table A, this is table B, and table C is holding the relationship between A to B. That would not be the most optimum purpose, optimum, you can say, solution. So to achieve those things, Cosmos DB is having graph part. To achieve something like, let's say, I'm building something like Amazon, and in my database, let's say I started building Amazon using relational database. So how my table looks like a very dumb table. It looks like product ID, product name, or might be a table for mobile. So mobile ID, mobile name, features. So let's say front camera, this megapixel, rear camera, this megapixel, Bluetooth, this version, Wi-Fi, this version, like this. Let's say just next day, another mobile launched and its feature is not listed in the column. So now your database not only growing vertically, but also horizontally. So you need something where you can not only add rows, but also you can add columns. You know, sometimes you will be facing those challenges that my data is kind of schema free. Then the word no schema or schema less databases comes in the picture. So one thing is key value. You are having key, and value can be entire video, value can be just a string, value can be your image. Those things, key value thing, just like you are as of now storing data in table storage or blob storage. Column family, so just like you are your table grows vertically, similarly you can add columns as well. So it supports column family as well. Document, so MongoDB is as of now what I believe is one of the most popular NoSQL database. So it supports 100% compatibility with MongoDB APIs. So if you are having your already running app supporting MongoDB, you can support Cosmos DB without any code changes. And the graph database. So graph database are applicable for those scenarios which I already explained. Like you want to find out shortest path between two cities. You want to find out common number of friends between two friends, those kind of scenarios. So those kind of scenarios can be achieved with relational database as well, but we are trying to force wrong technology to achieve that purpose. So to achieve those things, graph is the perfect thing. So this is one database which is supporting all four different types of ways through which we store data in databases. So this is just one database which stores, which facilitates four types of data saving. And not only this, it's monstrous. When we talk about Cosmos DB, we talk about terabyte, petabytes. It's so monstrous. And another thing is, let's say your database in just few MBs, then also it is that much efficient. So scaling your database from few MBs to few terabytes or few petabytes is just a matter of few clicks on the Azure portal. That's it. And that too from entire globe. That's why we call this database as a planet scale. So here are the few features about this database. How I planned my session is, half of the session is divided in describing the features of Cosmos DB. And in the next half, I'll show you how I planned my, I'm getting married on 20th of November, how I planned my honeymoon trip for Europe, which will be multi-city Europe trip using Cosmos DB, where multiple cities will be involved and I need to calculate something using graphs. I need to find out optimum places, optimum routes. So I've just implemented initial 20-30% of features, of you can say very basic, which can be coded in just 4 hours or 5 hours. But that whole scenario can be achieved using all the features available in Cosmos DB itself. So global distribution, it can be distributed globally. So as of now, Microsoft is having around 30 plus data centers globally available. So if here at Singapore, your app went viral and your users are traveling to Europe, still they are hitting that region data center, which is in Singapore. For example, I'm talking about not a long ago, but just 1.5 years back, India was not at all having any data center of their own. So whenever we guys need to deploy our web application on Azure, we need to deploy on Singapore data center because that was the nearest from India at that time. Today, India is having three data centers of their own. So latency matters. So if we are getting data, if we are getting HTTP response from Singapore, then obviously latency will be more. And if my data is locally present there itself, then latency will be most optimum. So that's the reason why we can achieve global distribution and we can achieve very less latency with the help of this database, with the help of just few clicks. So I'll show you in Azure portal during the end part of my talk, how I'll be replicating my Singapore database to Netherlands or to US. Another thing is guaranteed low latency. Microsoft is very aggressive about few SLAs which they introduced. I mean, before this database came into picture, we have heard the word SLA with some other concepts. Never with the in relation with database, that Microsoft is saying you will be receiving your data, you will be able to read your data 99% of time, or 99% is not the right word, 99 percentile. Percentile is different in percent, in less than 10 milliseconds. So this is wow factor, irrespective of where your actual user is present. So even if your user is in South Africa, and still he'll be able to get the response in less than 10 millisecond, or ideally might be in two milliseconds. So this is the commitment or SLA Microsoft is giving. So they are giving 4.49 SLAs, 99.99% times. This will be the millisecond time, less than 10 millisecond. So first time Microsoft introduced SLA thing in reading the data. Otherwise, we used to hear this from SLA in like software is being supported by a particular company, for how long this hardware or HP laptop is being supported by HP company. So those things. First time when you are fetching data from database, SLA introduced in the picture. Five consistency model. So let's say as your database is not in picture, you want to achieve the same thing. You are writing your data in database and your users are getting data from the data center which is nearest to them, right? How you will achieve consistency? At some time, some backend job or which was always running, whose sole purpose will be to replicate data. Okay, this data is updated, okay, update it everywhere. Although in those cases, how we used to code, we make one data as a master DB and make it right, we perform write operations in just one database and read operations from all the replicas, right? So same concept Microsoft is doing behind the scenes. So you need to focus only on your app, and those data replication features, those latency features, those SLA features will be taken care by Microsoft. So global distribution I have explained. Let's see if there is any new point. Yeah, the fourth point is the one which always excites me. I need not to code anything. So before mobile developer, I was also a web developer. I need to write load balancer by myself. I have to take that pain that with configuring my load balancer that, okay, if request is coming from this IP and this IP belongs to this country or this continent, then it should be redirected to this data server or web server. This need not to be done. Your application will always be able to connect with the nearest possible data center. So the fourth point is something which is my favorite. And this is the another thing. You need not to make a lot of configurations. You can achieve similar things with other databases also, but you need to configure your database a lot. In fact, you need to code as well a lot. But here, no configuration is required at all. Yeah, Elasticscale, you know, might be some of you have written deployed web role, worker roles on Azure, or might be Azure web apps, where you must have seen a slider where you can increase the number of physical servers, 2 VMs, 10 VMs, 20 VMs, or that can be coded. If 1,000 users are online, then automatically your app will be replicated over 2 virtual machines from 1. If 10,000 users are online, your application will be replicated over 1,000 virtual machines. So what would be the perfect scenario for the, let's say some match is going on, Barcelona versus Manchester United, and on the very same particular time, 1 hour or 2 hour, that server will be getting huge amount of load, right? So normally my server will be running on just on 10 virtual machines or 2 virtual machines, but on that particular 2 hours, I might be needing 10,000 virtual machines. So that kind of scalability, so much flexibility, we can achieve using Cosmos DB as well. Okay. SLA is the same thing. It guarantees 10 ms milliseconds SLA, and you need not to take care about indexing. So indexing is some concept. I love Microsoft because of this thing. Microsoft is developer friendly. Why I'm saying this? People know if you will be managing threat safety beautifully, then your app will be responsive. But developers try to avoid. I'll not be doing this in background thread. Let's keep it in worker thread or UI thread. It's a UI thread. Then Microsoft introduced the concept of task. Okay, you need not to worry about callbacks and threads and thread join, thread sleep, thread wait. Just create a task and do your stuff. Similarly, here Microsoft will be taking the pain how your application will be scaling up, how your latency will be minimized. You need not to do anything else in your code that to which endpoint you need to hit or to which endpoint you need to target. So that's the best thing. SLA 99.9%, as I already explained, 4-digit SLA Microsoft is offering, and which is kind of best within its competitors. No other competitor as of now with this much confidence is providing this much SLA time. Yeah, so some people says, okay, what about if I'm a Python developer? I wrote application, my mobile application in Xamarin, or might be in Swift, or might be in Java, but my server-side code is written in Python, Node.js. So can I still store my data in Cosmos DB? Yes, from the day one, multiple languages are supported, multiple APIs are available, and best thing is, everything is REST-based. So even let's say Google's Go is not mentioned here. Using that language as well, you can call REST APIs. So these SDKs are strongly typed SDKs, right? If your language is not here in the list, still you can call REST endpoints. So entire Cosmos DB is REST-based. You call REST APIs, and you can consume Cosmos DB data from those languages which is not mentioned in this data, in this table. Cosmos DB mainly contains document DB kind of APIs, Azure table storage kind of APIs, graph, and normal key value pairs. Okay. So entire thing is actually an independent service in Azure other than graph. Graph they introduced with Cosmos DB itself. So in this session, I covered most part of document DB. So in document DB, let's have a look how we store data. So there is a main database, which we named as document DB. And this is the outer one is the account. And then it is containing a database. There we are having multiple users, just like we are having different users in our SQL server or Oracle or MySQL. And those users will be having permissions or roles. So till here it is same, but this part is bit different. So now try to correlate, although correlating a RDBMS with NoSQL or document DB is not the right thing, but try to correlate. Whatever your tables are in RDBMS, those are kind of collections here. Not exactly, but similar to tables. Then we are having for each row, we can have documents. And then for each entry, we can store binary data as well. So let's say you stored one JSON, I'll show you. How, let's say in for the first row I'm having 4 parameters, in the next row I'm having 250 parameters. So my data will, space will not be wasted. So if you are having that kind of jacked arrays kind of data, so let's say one user registered with just 4 parameters because you want to get users registered in your application. So you cannot ask user from the day one, okay, fill all the 20 fields, just fill your username, password, and let's get started. So might be some users filled 2 fields, while all other users filled 20 fields, 50 fields. So those kind of things where one user is having very less amount of data, another user is having very large amount of data, and it is growing. So there is, you cannot waste those 18 columns for the first user, right? From the day one, you cannot waste that space if it is relational database. So you can achieve this in a very optimum way using document DB kind of thing or MongoDB kind of thing. Similar to SQL, they are supporting a stored procedure, just like SQL Server or just like Oracle. So you can write compiled SQL, and you can just call that, okay, my entire big query, which is using four complex joins and a view and something like that. You just need to give the name of your query, and your query will be executed from the database, and it will give the data. So you never need to pass whole big amount of text in the form of query. So it supports stored procedure as well. It supports trigger as well. Send me a callback, send me a notification when a new row or a new document will be added to the collection, okay? And it always supports UDF, user-defined function. So I think that, let's say, like a string compare, I want to override a string compare and I want to add more features. I can create my UDF, my user-defined function. So that also supports by Cosmos DB, document DB part of Cosmos DB. So what Microsoft did, they know that people are very much comfortable with SQL Server, SQL query language. And this storing data in this format is very much different than relational database. So is there any way through which you are writing SQL query, select star from this and get this, and you are getting data in the form of JSON documents? Can you do this? So they achieved this thing. They mapped SQL kind of language with NoSQL database, the best of both worlds. Your database is efficient. There is no new learning curve in learning writing queries. So that I'll be showing you in the demo. Yeah. So let's have a very small snippet of code just to get it started. Very small snippet. What we need to do? We need to just install this package, which is written in green color. Then we need to import this namespace. And then we need to create the client of DocumentDB, just like you create a client of table storage, or if you have any other thing. This is a very simplest possible code snippet just to get started with DocumentDB. And then you have to provide your endpoint URI and your string, or your private string, connection string. And then with the help of document URI, you are passing your database name, your collection name. So try to correlate collection name with the table name. And then your document ID. Each document can be unique, so can have a unique ID through which you can fetch a unique document, a unique JSON in a big chunk of JSON document. And here you are retrieving your data. So as you can see, this thing is strong. It is not at all, strongly typed. You can pass any object. So let's say item can have four properties. Item can have 400 properties. And it will try to map items in the same way how your JSON is stored. So there will be no fixed schema, but you are having fixed model, POCO, plain old CLR object, right? So this is the best thing. They are trying to match best of both worlds. So let's start this demo. How I built this app targeting iPhone X and Android Oreo, where this is a very simple UI which I created in just 3-4 hours. And this is the first screen, and there will be another screen. So I have just marked few cities which I already visited, some description about it. So what we will see, let's have a look. Okay, so here is a simple app. As you can see, it's a Xamarin Forms app targeting Android and iOS. You will see the part which is responsible to get data from Cosmos DB is so small and so easy to read that there is almost no learning curve to implement Cosmos DB in your app. And one very important thing I forgot to tell you, that Cosmos, you can start Cosmos DB without providing any credit card, without having any Azure subscription as well. So for using Azure services, you need to at least have free Azure subscription, right? For this, you not even required any type of Azure subscription. It's free to use for first 24 hours, then you can enhance that thing. And if you like it, then you can pay. So these are the two services I created. I mean, just services one. One is the contract, and another one is implementation, right? So we'll be getting cities, we'll be creating a collection, we'll be first creating a database if it is not already created. We'll save a city and we'll delete a city. So a simple crude operations, create, read, update, delete. So let's open its implementation. As some of you told that you have already used table storage, some of you might be, or blob storage. So the API, nature of APIs is very much similar to that. If your collection is not created, then create it. Once you create it, then store data in it or create a document in it. So that is the way. So we'll just go through with this code and you'll find that it is very simple. So here you are creating a new collection, and yeah, this is the main thing. You can change the throughputs unit through your code, which is not provided by any other database, at least not in my knowledge. You are managing throughput via code. It's like you are managing scaling. Few years back, you were managing scaling using code that, okay, once in your server-side application, your session count will be 1,000 users, then you are creating the replica of your virtual machines, and your application will be deployed from 2 virtual machines to 20 virtual machines. If your users, how you will count how many users are online? By counting the sessions in web applications. If your session count is, again, 10,000, then, okay, deploy my application to from 20 to 200 server. So similar kind of things you can achieve using Cosmos DB as well. You can mention throughput. This thing, getting data with the help of LinQ-like syntaxes is very awesome. Whether you are writing a LinQ query against an in-memory collection, or a document DB, or a table storage, or a Cosmos DB, your LinQ, the way you are fetching data, the way you write LinQ query is same. So you here, you haven't learned any new query language, which you always learn whenever you start learning a new database, right? Again, saving a city is also same. You are replacing a document. Why? Because if might be that city is already available, then you are saving the city. So let's run this application. Let me set iOS as a startup project. And this constant thing, I have already added these constants, but let me first create a new Cosmos DB instance so that you can know how we can create a new Cosmos DB database on Azure portal. So we do new Cosmos DB. Best thing is that GUI screen where with the help of just one single click, your database will be replicated to multiple data centers. I need to give some account ID like MonkeyFest demo. I need to give it in all lowercase. I need to choose API, okay? Which API I want to use to access my data, whether it's document DB, table storage, graph based, or table, just a key value pairs. Like, so it gives me flexibility to choose API of my choice, depending upon my business scenario or my use case, and we can access data in that way. So let's access document DB, and I'm using any existing resource, so let's choose any POC. And as you can see here, South India, so let's select Southeast Asia, yep. And this checkbox, by default, it will create 2 replications. So in Singapore itself, it will deploy in one data center as a master one and another one as its replication. If you want to scale it on more, even more, like scale it to Europe or to US, then you can again, there is a new UI from where you can replicate it. That we will see. And from here, we can create it. So it will be created in approx 4 to 5 minutes. But I am already having a one which is already created. So we'll have a look at it. This is the one which is already created. So as you can see, this screen is very important. Whatever checkbox or radio button, whatever you want to say it. I'll take my database behind the scenes very in a very transparent way, will be replicated in that data center. So as of now, when I was creating this demo 2 days back, it was just two data centers among the three available in India. Right now we are somewhere here. So it was one was master and another was one was this replica. So if I want to replicate towards Europe, towards Netherlands, all I want to do is just check this. I need to first open it in full screen and now I can check this. So North Europe I have checked in. Now people who are in far continent, they can also access the data with the same latency, less than 10 milliseconds. So this is nowhere available with any other database till date. And I can save it. So as you can see, important thing is you can see right region just South India, while read regions are Central India and North Europe. So you can have just one right region, because if there will be multiple write regions, then there will be concurrency issues. But to minimize the latency, 90% of times we perform read operations. Very few times we perform write operations, right? So multiple users can read data which is being created by all other users at the same time in a concurrent way. But to achieve this in the form of writing it is almost impossible or very hard to achieve. So that's why there will be always one write region, and there will be as many as you want read regions. So this is how you will scale it. Let's close it. And let's explore the data. So you just saw that nature of data is very much different. There is no schema. It is no schema database. But the query that you will be using is very much familiar. So let's first see the query explorer. Select a star from C, something very common. I think we are familiar with this from our college time, if we have studied in college computer science, where C dot visited equal to true. I mean, C is city here. The data I'll receive are not the rows, they are the JSON. So might be one document, the upper part of JSON can have 5 properties, second part can have 10, third part can have 200 properties. So this is the flexibility. So if I run the same app here, and it is already running in Android as well. It's running in, now it is running in iPhone X emulator. Yeah, so you can see there are few changes in that title bar, how you are using that space. So let's mark Vienna as visited, save. So here, Amsterdam is there, Paris is there, Den Haag and Frankfurt. Let me run this query again. And then you can see Vienna as well. So, I mean, it is just a lame or demo, but you can see that the moment you update your database, you can replicate the JSON there. And if there is JSON, so nowadays since last four years, transferring data from one component to another, from data to database layer, from database layer to business layer, from business layer to JavaScript UI or mobile UI or a Raspberry Pi UI, JSON is the most common standard. So why not let's save data on the very first place in the JSON format? Why we are saving data in relational form, converting it in JSON form using new terms of JSON, and then binding the UI. So now we are saving data in JSON format and using the features or benefits of saving data in JSON, because there is no schema now. First document can have 4 fields, another one can have 400 fields. That's the beauty. Similar to this, so at the time of creating a database, I just selected DocumentDB. There is a graph as well, table as well, and key value pair as well. In graph as well, there will be animated graph. So one node is there, two, three nodes are other place, and there are multiple edges which are connecting to one node to another node or vertices, right? So that those things can be also achieved visually. And you can also place icon. So I can always show one city. Let's say I can show Paris as icon of Eiffel Tower in this Azure UI itself. So that much capable this portal is. Back to slides. Just last two slides. And then we'll have questions. So you just saw this demo, which is available on GitHub. You can always, on Git, I also checked in my connection strings as well. So I'll be deleting my database after this session, and you can create your own database and point, just change the connection string in constant.cs. So you can ask questions. I have 4 magazines of my companies. Five magazines. So you can ask questions and you can get these magazines. So it's question time. I want to make it very less boring and very concrete one. Yeah. Can you repeat once again?
I saw you put those throughput value in your code, hard coded the throughput value in your C# code, right?
Mm-hmm.
Let's say when you deploy to the Azure, the throughput is more than the value you define in your code.
Mm-hmm.
So how are you going to handle it? Are you going to change the code?
That 400 thing was as of now defined, in a hard-coded way.
Yeah.
But generally, that 400 part should be taken care by server-side code. So right now, I'm directly accessing this data from my mobile code. Generally, my server-side code will be responsible to access this data from server and then giving it back to mobile. So server always knows how many users are connecting or trying to access this data. So on the basis of that, server passes that 400, 800, 200, or just 40, that kind of thing to Cosmos DB APIs. It can be achieved if you are writing server-side code, because you can always know how many concurrent users are connected, but you are not at all aware about any other user if you are writing the same code in mobile application. You are not at all aware, you cannot come to know that what other user is doing, how many total users are being connected, so that thing. Or might be another ways for this particular concurrent throughput part, you can again making a call to your server and you are asking server, okay, tell me how many users are connected right now. If server says, oh, I'm heavily loaded. So you will be passing some other values of throughput from mobile app.
Okay, so I have another question for Cosmos DB. Do we have a local version instead of our own connector?
Local, yeah, it is having a local emulator as well. It's a command line based emulator.
I have no need to connect to the Azure database.
When
during the development phase, right?
Not all the features, but a limited set of features you can achieve using a local, very small subset of those features. So there is a command line based emulator.
There is a command line emulator installed in the Windows or Linux machine.
It is only, as of now, it is only available for Windows, not for Mac or Unix.
Only for Windows.
So, one magazine for you. Yeah, anyone else? Yeah. You go first.
How do you achieve offline?
Offline syncing kind of thing. Offline syncing like something what Realm DB do. Some databases are there which by default natively supports offline syncing. That okay, once your application will be available, your application, once your database will be available or internet is available, your application will be syncing that data to server and getting the data, or might be syncing the local changes to server. So it is not by default performing it. You need to manually write logic on your local thing. RealmDB is a database that performs this, I think so. Yeah. Have your magazine.
I'm pretty new in Cosmos DB. To check, what is the technical constraint that you have been working on with this DB? As in, did you encounter any technical constraint on implementing it? That's the first question. The second question is, how would you not recommend using Cosmos DB in some cases?
I'll try to think the second question first. Why not to recommend Cosmos DB? If you are having a very relational kind of data as per your business requirements, then why to go for Cosmos DB? Cosmos DB is not at all, its syntax is SQL still, but the way it stores data is not at all relational. Even if you choose key value pair or table storage or document DB, if you are having something where you need to establish primary key, foreign key kind of relationship with just one table, two table, then just go for well-proven things, RDBMS.
So how about
it? Yeah,
so
can you please pass? Constraints in using Cosmos DB. I didn't find anything. Like document DB was already there. If some people says we want some premium capabilities, we want some mind-blowing latency. Okay, what? How to achieve this? Microsoft, okay. Use Cosmos DB. So let's say today's a new concept is going viral, which is microservices. Microservices says in your entire application there are multiple features, and which features needs what type of database support that. So might be one feature of your database needs RDBMS. Implement RDBMS. One feature of your application needs graph database, support graph database. Like Amazon, if I want to do just cart management, I can use RDBMS. If I want to save the catalog, I'll go for NoSQL kind of thing, because one phone can have 8 features, another phone can have 80 features, right? So in those words, why to go targeting multiple databases, and we will be scaling them. So let's have the whole four different kinds of requirements in one database, and we can entirely scale it, and we can entirely replicate it to multiple geographies.
As a mobile developer perspective, what would you recommend for the Firebase
and Cosmos DB? As of now, what I believe, Firebase is not at all providing this scenario that you wrote a very wonderful $1 million app, it went viral in Singapore, suddenly it starts getting viral in Europe and US, and you are not at all having time, you need to attract investors. You cannot write code overnight to support your app from multiple geographies. How you can support those features from the day one? So in those scenarios, from the day one, let's support Cosmos DB. If you found, your co-founder says, hey, I saw there are a lot of traffic. Your application insights is saying a lot of traffic is coming from Europe, but we made it just for Singapore. So let's make another checkbox checked, and your database will be replicated in Europe as well.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Just now you mentioned about the shortest route.
Shortest route.
Problem. So I have this problem that we need to solve this.
We
need to like have
a
shortest route.
Yep.
Right? And then the second problem is the postman problem.
Postman problem, yeah.
So is this like feasible to do that?
Yes. So the graph database supports a very well accepted, which is a query language, which is known as Gremlin. GREMLIN. That's a query language which supports graph database. and you can access graph using Gremlin or using SQL syntaxes as well.
Okay, so the so-called API, the API to the sorters not there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. So yeah, for using Gremlin, you are writing your query. Get me from this node to that node. There are multiple ways. Get me the optimum ways. So you can achieve this from there because it gives you the count. That okay, this way is having this weightage. If you are trying to go from this way, this point to this right point using way C, then it is having this much weightage. You can count the weightage and you can get the most optimum route.
Because the data is geometry, right?
Mm-hmm. You need to search the path order. Yeah, or traveling salesman kind of problem where you're No, they are using some logic behind the scenes and it is very optimum. All you can do is you need to configure your data in that way, in the form of graph. Yes, you need to just give them data and you need to write two type of queries. Either you can write SQL kind of query to access graph database. SQL is meant for RDBMS, not for graph. Still, they are providing SQL. Or you can, if you are mastered in Gremlin, you can write Gremlin.
Second question, is it we can put the data on memory so they have the in-memory data?
In memory,
yeah.
But why you want to do so? It is a lot faster. It cannot be faster with less than 10 ms, or might be if it's faster, but still there is a lot of overhead. Why you are taking a lot of overhead to always taking care? Okay, when I'll be getting the updated data, let's persist it in database or in that data center or in that data center. Why to keep in memory in that scenario? If there is something which is very much needed for the very short amount of time, then you can create in memory collections or observable collections. But otherwise, for example, in my case as well, there were three tabs: visited cities, all, and not visited cities. So that thing I have managed in memory. Is the emulator visible? So this thing, visited, when I tap on visited, when I tap on not visited, it is not at all again and again hitting the database. This is fetching the data from in memory. Your book. Can you pass at the back? Thank you. Yeah. Any other questions? But no more books I'm having. Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Just now the guy asked about limitation. And realize they got one more limitation. Mm-hmm. When we do e-commerce on website or apps, then Cosmos DB seems to have a bad choice because we can't have like the transaction ID.
Mm-hmm.
And we can do like rollback.
So to achieve transaction ID kind of scenarios, it is having the concept of partition key. If you will be storing that data in table storage format, not in document DB. And there you are having row key and partition key, and through which you can uniquely identify each row the way you did in transaction, in cases of transactions. You uniquely identify transaction by using transaction ID. Similarly, you can still uniquely identify each row by the combination of row key and partition ID in table storage APIs.
Is it one UID?
No, you just pass row key and partition ID, combination of both, and you'll get the unique key. So it's like indexing behind the scenes. That's
a way.
It's kind of good.
Oh, good. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Question is a private question. Does anyone ever convert the RDBMS database?
Any comparison?
No. What's the fact? Is there anyone to converting?
Converting? Yeah. You can import your MongoDB data, your JSON data here. So there is import wizards as well. You can import your data. Anyone else? Yeah. In AWS, might be DynamoDB, but not completely. DynamoDB, there is a DynamoDB in AWS, which is counterpart of DocumentDB, not the CosmosDB. Okay. Okay, thanks a lot. Yeah. Yeah. Firebase.
Google's present, Google itself have another similar support for most people. What you see is called
Spanner.
Which one is Spanner?
As of now, I'm not having any such comparison because I have used only Cosmos DB. Somewhat, I have little bit used DynamoDB of AWS, but Cosmos DB is big umbrella. You can compare DynamoDB to DocumentDB, but not other databases to enter Cosmos DB. You can compare other databases to one part of Cosmos DB, as per your need. Okay, thanks a lot. I hope you will enjoy.